Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is risk assessment. We will deal with this topic under the two main subheadings. That is, first we will discuss various terminologies that are used interchangeably and they are confusing amongst each other. And second, we will discuss the Langen-Tonetti risk assessment model given in the year 2003. So first, we will enlist the various terminologies that are used interchangeably. First is risk factor, second risk determinant or background characteristic, third is risk indicator, and the last, fourth and final is risk predictor or marker. These are the four terminologies used interchangeably and are confusing. So we will first clarify what each of the terminology stands for and what message they convey. The main terminology is risk factor. This is the main terminology, risk factor, which stands for mainly risk. That is, they increases the likelihood of developing the disease but do not cause the disease. Please keep in mind all these terminologies that is associated with risk, that is increased chances of developing the disease, but they directly don't cause the disease. If they were to cause the disease, they would have been discussed under the topic etiology of the periodontal diseases and not risk. That is why they are being discussed here in the topic risk. So risk factors, be it environmental, behavioral, systemic, environmental or biological, let's say genetics, anything, it can be anything, but they increases the likelihood or chances of developing the disease, but they directly don't cause the disease. That is the main point. Second main point is they are confirmed through longitudinal studies. I hope everybody is clear with the various types of epidemiological studies. Understanding that you are aware of the concept about various epidemiological studies, I am discussing the topic hereby. So, risk factors are confirmed through longitudinal studies. This is the second main point. Longitudinal studies confirmation. Clear? Now, the examples of risk factor are mainly tobacco smoking, systemic disease such as mainly diabetes, and the most common, which is also in etiology, that is microbiology, the putative pathogens. Clear? Coming to risk determinant. Now, the name itself suggests determinant or background characteristics. The first thing about them is they cannot be modified, which is in contrast to risk factors, which are modifiable. Now, going back to risk factors, which are confirmed through longitudinal studies, the thing about those risk factors that we discussed, such as tobacco smoking or diabetes or even the microbiology, these risk factors, the exposure to these risk factors may be at single point of time or multiple points of time or even continuous, but the exposure has to be before the onset of the disease so as to assign it the name risk factor, which increases the likelihood of developing the disease. That is, the exposure to such risk factors should be prior to the onset of the disease. And when such exposures are identified, interventions can be framed or developed for the same, and such interventions can thus modify these risk factors. So that is another main point about risk factors, that is, they are modifiable. In contrast to this property of risk factors, that is, they are modifiable, risk determinant or background characteristics, the name itself suggests, that is, they determine the risk, they are background characteristics, they are not at the forefront, they cannot be modified. Now the examples for this non-modifiable risk determinant or background characteristics are mainly age, gender, stress, socio-economic status. Clear? These are the things which cannot be modified. Now coming to third terminology, that is risk indicator. Now, the contrasting point here is risk indicators are confirmed through cross-sectional studies and not longitudinal studies. Cross-sectional studies are one-point time studies. Clear? So these indicators, that is, they indicate something. Example, HIV, AIDS, osteoporosis, or even the frequency of past dental visits. Such factors are called risk indicators, which are not confirmed through longitudinal studies. They are only confirmed in cross-sectional studies. They are also risk factors, but confirmed only in cross-sectional studies. Coming to the last terminology, that is risk predictor or marker. They are very similar to risk factors, confirmed or verified through both cross-sectional studies and longitudinal studies. And that is why they are very similar to risk factors, that is, associated with increased likelihood of developing the disease but do not cause the disease. Examples for risk predictor or marker, just go by the name, it is very easy to remember and understand. Predictor or marker, which predicts the progression or the course or the outcome of the disease. Predictor, for example, bleeding on probing and previous history of periodontal breakdown. Clear? These are the finally four terminologies and their contrasting differences. Now we will discuss the Lang and Tonetti model of risk assessment given in the year 2003. But before discussing this model, we will discuss a general outline of risk assessment. Risk assessment comprises of taking thorough case history. Now, case history contains mainly demographic data, that is, name, gender, age, etc., followed by medical history, dental history, and clinical examination. After recording a thorough case history, we can determine the risk and determine the prognosis, and on the basis of the case history, risk assessment, and determination of prognosis, our treatment plan can be outlined. So now, risk assessment, as already discussed now, contains case history taking, mainly demographic data, medical history, dental history, and clinical examination. So what Lang and Tonetti in the year 2003, according to their functional diagram model, did is they chose few representative risk factors from each of the category. So now we will discuss each of the following factor in detail. To begin with, bleeding on probing. First of all, bleeding on probing is an objective inflammatory marker. Please remember, objective inflammatory marker. Now the question, why bleeding on probing is chosen? Because bleeding on probing is representative of multiple factors, that is, on the microbial aspect, on the host aspects, etc. Altogether, bleeding on probing represents patient's oral hygiene maintenance status, that is, patient's compliance in maintaining the oral hygiene, the patient's host response, the microbial status within, that is, residing within the oral cavity, and the overall status of the oral cavity. Generally, bleeding on probing represents the overall hygiene status, especially when coupled with residual probing death after the active therapy is completed, which represents the efficiency or the treatment outcome of the treatment rendered. Clear? So, although bleeding on probing alone cannot be a good predictor of the periodontal disease activity, but if coupled with probing depths, residual probing depths, it is a good predictor of future loss of attachment. But conversely, absence of bleeding on probing is an excellent predictor of periodontal stability. So, now we will discuss what is the status of bleeding on probing on this functional diagram. Clear? Generally, a cutoff point of 25% is set between patients with periodontal stability versus patients with periodontal breakdown or at risk for periodontal breakdown. That is, generally between 20 to 30%. If patients have bleeding on probing between 20 to 30%, they are considered high risk patients. Clear? Now, the scale for bleeding on probing is in a quadratic manner, that is, squares of the numbers. Let's see, number 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So 2 square is 4, 3 square 9, 4 square 16, 5 square 25, 6 square 36 and 7 square 49. These are the 6 points in a quadratic fashion for bleeding on probing. Remember, the scale for different factors are different. This is the scale only for bleeding on probing. Now here, how is the demarcation done? That is, bleeding on probing less than 10% are low risk patient, and 25% is the cutoff for high risk patient. So this is moderate risk patient, and above 25 is high risk patient. This is how the demarcation for bleeding on probing is done. Once again, why bleeding on probing is chosen as the first indicator in this diagram? Because it represents patient's oral hygiene maintenance status, patient's host response, and the levels of the microorganisms that resides within the oral cavity. Especially when coupled with resident probing depth, it is a good predictor of future loss of attachment, and conversely, absence of bleeding on probing is an excellent predictor of periodontal stability. Clear? That is why we have bleeding on probing as the first indicator on this diagram in Langenthalitis risk assessment model. Now, coming to probing depth, that is prevalence of probing depth greater than or equal to 5 mm. This factor is essentially a representation of success of the treatment that is rendered, the active therapy completion, the success of the treatment outcomes. Clear? This factor, when coupled with bleeding on probing or with suppuration, is indicative of the potential sites or niche that are at risk for reinfection, or which may pose a risk for reinfection and infect the other sites which are otherwise treated and healthy. That is why it is necessary to record the residual probing depth greater than or equal to 5 mm. Now, the scale for probing depth runs in linear fashion. That is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 and 12. Here the cutoff point is up to 4 residual probing depths of greater than or equal to 5 mm is low risk patient, and up to 8 is moderate risk. If more than 8 probing depths greater than or equal to 5 mm are found, then they are high risk patient. This is the cutoff and demarcation on the linear scale for probing depths. Now, these two entities, that is bleeding on probing and probing depths, represents the clinical examination. Clear? Now we will discuss loss of teeth, which is a representation of past dental diseases or trauma or any past dental history. That is past dental history. It also represents patient's oral hygiene maintenance, its ability or capacity to maintain the oral hygiene or dentition. Now, why loss of teeth is necessary? See, even the dentition with a short dental arch can work. That is, let's say molars are lost. But if more than 8 teeth are lost, then the dentition is compromised. The functionality is partly lost. And that is why loss of teeth is essential to be discussed. Again, the scale for loss of teeth is linear. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 and 12. And the cutoff is strictly 8. Up to 8 teeth is manageable, that is with short dental arch. But if more than 8 teeth are lost, then the functionality of dentition is lost. This is the main rationale behind discussing loss of teeth in this functional diagram or the risk assessment model. Up to 4 teeth lost is low risk patient, up to 8 is moderate risk, but more than 8 is high risk patients. Because if more than 8 teeth are lost, the functionality of the dentition is heavily compromised, and it may predispose the patient at developing other diseases of oral cavity. That is why loss of teeth. And that is why loss of teeth is the third factor in this diagram. Coming to the factor bone loss by age. In this factor, first, the bone loss is assessed from the worst affected site on either periapical radiographs or bitwig radiographs. If it is on periapical radiograph, then the worst affected site is estimated in terms of percentage of bone loss. And if it is a bitwig radiograph, then the bone loss is estimated in terms of millimeter. And 1 millimeter is equal to 10% of bone loss. This way, the bone loss is estimated first, remember, from the worst affected site, and then that bone loss is divided by age. Now, the scale for bone loss runs in the multiples of 0.25, that is 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, 1, 1.25 and 1.5. Clear? Where the cutoff is 0.5 for low risk and 1 is the cutoff between moderate risk and high risk. So, the factor value greater than 1 represents high risk. I'll explain. I'll give you two examples. For a patient with age 40 years, if the bone loss is 20%, then 20 by 40 is 0.5. So, a 40-year patient representing 20% bone loss is a low-risk patient. But a 40-year-old patient having 50% bone loss, that is 50 by 40, which gives 1.25, will be high-risk patient. So, this means a patient suffering bone loss in percentage greater than its age is a high-risk patient. Clear? Remember, a person with bone loss in percentage higher than or greater than his or her own age is a high-risk patient according to this factor, bone loss by age. This represents the past dental history and the demographic data incorporation. Clear? Coming to the next, that is fifth indicator, systemic or genetics. We all know systemic diseases such as diabetes, whether present or absent. And genetics, we have already progressed, advanced in terms of the genetic markers, mainly interleukin polymorphisms, which are if present or absent. So the scale for this is very clear. If it is present, we mark it as high risk. If it is absent, it is not considered at all. Either yes or no. Clear? This is the scale for systemic or genetic factors because of its impact or influence on the periodontal disease activity and progression. Remember, systemic disease is mainly diabetes. If the diabetic status is uncontrolled or known otherwise to be diabetic, then we mark it as a high-risk patient. And if it is not known or absent, then it is not counted or accounted at all. Coming to the last, that is sixth factor, environmental factor. Here the representative is smoking status. Now, we have the scale in terms of non-smoker, former smoker, occasional smoker, moderate smoker and heavy smoker. Clear? So, obviously non-smoker and former smoker. Non-smoker means who doesn't smoke. Former smoker is who has left smoking 5 years before. That is, it has been 5 years that they have stopped consuming smoke. So, they are at low risk. Occasional smokers are somebody who consumes less than 10 cigarettes per day. And moderate smokers are who consumes 10 to 19 cigarettes per day. They are at moderate risk. And any heavy smoker who consumes the entire packet, that is 20 and above, they are high risk patient. This is the categorization for smoking status, that is the environmental factor on this diagram. So, this completes the functional diagram, that is Lang-Antonetti's risk assessment model. A quick summary, six factors, bleeding on probing, probing depth, that is residual probing depth greater than or equal to 5 mm, loss of teeth from 28 teeth, that is third molars are excluded and replacements are not counted, bone loss by age factor, systemic or genetic factors and environmental factors such as smoking. The scale for bleeding on probing is quadratic fashion. Probing depths and loss of teeth are in linear fashion. Bone loss by age are in the multiples of 0.25. Systemic or genetic factors are either recorded as present or absent. And smoking status is recorded as non-smoker, former smoker, occasional smoker, moderate smoker and heavy smoker. Now we will understand what is a low risk assessment patient, moderate risk assessment patient and high risk assessment. So, quickly outlining all the three categories of risk assessment patient. In the low risk profile, we had somewhat this zone or at max this shape of zone which was smaller in size relatively. For a moderate risk patient which says 2 in the moderate risk category and at max 1 in the high risk category. So, the zone was bigger and bigger comparatively. Let's say this fashion. Clear? See, the size increases as the risk increases. And for for the high risk, two in the high risk category, and others can be in either low, moderate or high risk. So it was high. Clear? So see, the zone gets bigger as the risk increases. Clear? These are the 6 points. 3, 4, 5, 6. Clear? So these are the various profiles of low risk category, moderate risk category and high risk category. This completes the risk assessment as per Lang and Tonetti model given in the year 2003. And this completes our topic for today's video, that is risk assessment. We have discussed various terminologies which are interchangeably used and are confusing, that is risk factor, risk determinant or background characteristics, risk indicator and risk predictors or markers, followed by Lang and Tonetti's risk assessment model. If you are using any other risk assessment model and want me to discuss the same, feel free to write me in the comment section below or to my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. For today's video, that's all. I hope the topic is clear to you all and it is helpful. If you do find so, please like my videos, share it with your colleagues and friends, subscribe to my channel and hit that bell icon to get notified of my upcoming videos. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well, have a good day, stay safe.